Hi everyone, welcome back to the Mass Retirees Weekly Update. I'm Sean Duhamel. Thank you so much for joining with us today. Now, we have somewhat of a unique video update, a weekly news update for you. I am joined today by Dr. Brooke Worcester. She is the Chief Medical Officer for a Massachusetts-based company known as EOCare. We're engaging in a little bit of a survey. We want to solicit your opinions this week about a very particular topic, and that is medical marijuana or medical cannabis, which has now been legal here in Massachusetts for over a decade. It is actually 14 years now. It was legalized back in 2012 through a referendum. And why this is important is that there is a growing national movement in utilizing medical marijuana or cannabis and the various variations of it for medical purposes. In fact, the federal government is expected or anticipated later this year to change the classification of cannabis from a class one scheduled drug to a class three. And what that will do is it will make it a lot easier, so to speak, for medical marijuana to, in the future, potentially be covered by insurance companies, be prescribed by physicians. And we have been working with EOCare here in Massachusetts to understand the position of retirees, understand whether or not retirees are already utilizing medical marijuana for treatment of various conditions, whether you are a cancer patient or glaucoma or other various ailments where medical marijuana has proven to be very effective. Now, you might be asking, why in the world is Mass Retirees Association conducting a survey on pot? Well, that's a good question. And let me give you three very specific reasons. Statistically, we know that retirees are already using medical marijuana, but we don't know just how common that might be, how prevalent it is amongst our membership, and whether or not, even if you're not currently using medical marijuana, if this is something that you have an interest in. If, for instance, the insurance carriers begin to cover this type of medication, would it be something that you would be interested in at least having more information and knowledge about? And as I said a moment ago, you know, the federal government is on the verge of reclassifying cannabis from a Schedule 1 controlled substance to a Schedule 3 controlled substance. And that is going to be a major change in the regulation of medical marijuana and how it is approached going forward. And once the classification changes, there will be a growing push for healthcare providers to prescribe and insurance companies to cover medical marijuana. So to help to inform, you know, Mass Retirees' position on these issues and whether or not it is something that we should be sort of at the forefront of in advocating for safe usage and, you know, coverage by whether it's the GIC or Blue Cross and Blue Shield or Unicare, the other various insurance carriers here in Massachusetts, it is important for us to hear from members. And those of you who have been a member of Mass Retirees for a while know that our association has long prided itself in being at the forefront of healthcare policy, at the forefront of finding new ways to improve the lives of our members, while at the same time taking steps to gain control over the cost of healthcare. And healthcare affordability, of course, is something that you've heard us talk about quite frequently. It's been in the press on a regular basis in over the past several weeks and months, and we envision that this issue will continue to be really at the forefront of our day-to-day work in new approaches, new innovations, cutting-edge aspects to healthcare, such as medical marijuana and cannabis are all part of these conversations. So contained in today's weekly email message from us is a link to a survey. It is completely anonymous. What I mean by that is we're not going to know who you are or what your personal answers are. The information that's being provided through the survey is going to be used in the aggregate. What we are trying to do again is gain some knowledge and some insight into where our members stand on these issues. So we hope that you'll take a few moments to complete the survey. It's a quick survey. There's only a handful of questions, but it'll be very useful for us going forward. And then our intention is once we have this information, we will be reporting back to you in the coming weeks and potentially through a newsletter article in the July Voice on what the findings are. And we are going to share the information with EO Care. You know, they're working with us on this project. We'll also share it with the insurance providers here in Massachusetts, as well as with the GIC, just so everyone has that same information to inform, you know, where this may go in the future. But with that, let me introduce formally Dr. Brooke Worcester. Again, Brooke is the Chief Medical Officer for EO Care, has been a leader in this area. Brooke, thank you so much for taking the time this afternoon to join us. And maybe you can provide a little bit more insight into exactly what is EO Care and, you know, what you're doing in this space.
Yeah. Hi, Sean. Thanks for having me. I'm happy to. Background on me, so it makes a little bit more sense, is that kind of in my day job, I am a cancer pain management physician at the Sydney Kimmel Cancer Center in Philadelphia, and have long kind of been trying to help older adults and those with cancer and other vulnerable kind of chronic pain illnesses with pain management. And patients got me kind of into the cannabis space by asking about it. And so we started researching it. And that was kind of what led me toward EO. And really the biggest thing that I think is happening right now, and I'm sure a fair amount of your retirees are experiencing this, is that healthcare is kind of behind the eight ball in terms of engaging in conversations or really having kind of good knowledge about safe use for cannabis and who it might benefit and who actually shouldn't use it. And so often patients, caregivers are left a little bit in a lurch where they are trying to figure it out on their own, so to speak. And so what EO Care does in that space is try to use a combination of clinical guidance and AI language modeling to create a personalized kind of care plan for answering an individual's questions about how can I safely access cannabis? What should I be using? What shouldn't I be using? What products would be helpful? What products wouldn't? And helping just answer even some of the questions that people have. And so it's been sort of, I've seen it in the clinical space that this is guidance that people really need. And so it's been nice to kind of see this come to fruition for people to have easy access to something like this. Oh, Sean, I can't hear you.
Sorry about that, everybody. I hit the mute button. You know, as I said before, we're now 14 years in where this has been legal here in Massachusetts in terms of the medical application. Of course, there is a recreational component here in Massachusetts as well. And what we're talking about today is strictly the medical side of cannabis use. What are the sorts of maladies or ailments that folks mm-hmm. are often utilizing medical marijuana to treat?
That's a great question. And I think for sure, the two biggest that we see both statistically and kind of, you know, conversationally is side effects of cancer and cancer treatment, whether it's pain or nausea or difficulty sleeping, as well as pain, especially in older adults who are dealing with more chronic pain and have less options that are readily available because of other medical issues or medication interactions. Those are the two sort of diagnoses, the chronic pain and cancer related things that people are most often reaching to cannabis for.
And are there certain risks, you know, to utilizing cannabis? Is there a potential interaction with other medications that folks may have?
This is a really important question that we are increasingly finding out that, yes, there are some risks in certain populations and, more importantly, with specific forms of cannabis that are out there. Mostly driven by the rec market, there are some really potent products that contain very high dose THC. And when those products are either smoked or inhaled, which medically is something I never want my patients to do, it can in fact kind of cause issues with people that have underlying risk factors for a cardiovascular event, so a heart attack or a stroke. And so getting guidance about sort of what to avoid is important. And there can be some medication interactions depending on what formulation of the products you're using and what other medications you're on. So kind of doing it with, you know, out guidance or getting products off the internet or things like that, that's where people can run into some problems for sure.
And how can retirees or patients in general go about getting that guidance? I think that's a source of confusion. Mm-hmm. You have a conversation with your next door neighbor, or even if you went to a dispensary here in Massachusetts, mm-hmm. the advice you're getting, you're not necessarily sure who you're speaking with or what their qualifications or credentials may be for delivering that type of advice. So what can members do to try to protect themselves?
That's a really important part of this. And I don't fault dispensaries because, right, they aren't medical personnel, where it's sort of like asking your mechanic to do your taxes. Like, you just wouldn't do it. So, right, you as a patient walking in there are hoping for something that, you know, they're just not geared to provide. So I say, take what you hear from a dispensary if you're going in there with a grain of salt. And certainly, I think, you know, talking with friends and others who have used cannabis and benefited or have not benefited and have had side effects is certainly helpful and important. But in terms of kind of really medically based guidance, it's more difficult. I mean, I would suggest everyone ask whomever their, you know, most trusted physician or healthcare provider is as a start. Some of them might have some good knowledge and they might have a good place to point you towards. If they don't, there are some resources on every state's website. For instance, Massachusetts has a cannabis commission that has some interesting and sort of good educationally vetted materials. Pennsylvania does, other states do. But really great kind of wholesale guidance is hard to come by. And that's one of the pieces that EOCare is really trying to do for people, is to give scientifically vetted guidance to people. There's a way, thankfully, this is one of the uses of artificial intelligence that's helpful, is to be able to type in specific questions and get good responses that are sort of pulled from medical articles that have been published.
I think that's a good segue. And, you know, I think our members may have the question of who is EOCare? What's the focus here? Is EOCare a dispensary? And let me say at the outset, you know, this is not a sales pitch. We're not bringing this to you to sell you anything. As I said before, we know that retirees are already utilizing medical marijuana. Yeah. Many of you may have been utilizing it for more than a decade now. Because of that, we want to make sure that we're bringing you information that's valuable, perhaps information that is hard to come by through other sources because of the confusion around all of this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, working with EOCare to get their expertise and helping us put together this survey and bring some of this information to you, we thought was a logical step forward. But Brooke, if you could just talk a little bit about EOCare in general.
Yeah, it's not a dispensary. It has nothing to do with sort of selling cannabis products that are from dispensaries at all. What it is really a platform that enables technology to help give you the guidance to what the right products that might be helpful for you or might not. And the other kind of part of it is that it's a technology sort of online resource that can certainly also relay information. That's one of the things that I think is a helpful benefit for anybody that is just kind of curious about this or wanting to make sure that it or just even explore first what's helpful for them. Is it's a safe space to start to try to ask those questions and get some information. But again, I direct everybody back to their treating physicians as a first step, and a most important kind of trusted partner for you in terms of who you should sort of get guidance from. If I could direct you away from, you know, the cannabis dispensary personnel and kind of, you know, your neighbor's granddaughter, although she might be lovely, you know, maybe not giving you the right guidance for you medically.
So for members who are considering, you know, cannabis as a treatment option, You said the first step, talk to your treatment team, whether it's your doctor. If you are being treated for cancer, you have a care team. Approach your providers first. But if they were to utilize the services of EO Care, what would that look like?
That's a great question. I mean, they can certainly just go. I'm sure you guys will provide specific links to them too, but you can go on and simply Google EO Care. And what it would look like is an interface whereby you can both ask questions that you have specific to cannabis and whatever kind of diagnoses or troubling symptoms you have that you're thinking about using cannabis for. And you'll get some immediate feedback with the references and citations attached to that. It can also help you by putting in your information in terms of, I'm struggling with chronic pain and I take medications for high blood pressure and I have a history of high cholesterol and I really don't want to feel high or I don't want to smoke anything. And it can help create a safe, effective care plan for you as an individual that is sort of rooted in what your own kind of medical history involves.
Well, I don't want to get too deep into some of the technical aspects of this, but I think one common question on people's minds, if they are considering, using medical marijuana as a treatment option, is, the difference between CBD, THC. Depending on where you are, you may walk into your local, CVS or your neighborhood convenience store, and you see CBD products being sold on the countertop. And it's a little bit confusing as to what the different compounds are and what the impact may be on an individual.
Great question. And you will see it gets even more confusing as more of the cannabinoids or parts of the plant get out there even more. But the biggest difference between THC and CBD is that THC is what we call psychoactive, meaning it crosses into your brain and it's the thing that quote unquote gets you high. CBD has kind of anti-inflammatory and other effects that we know of from research that we've done in the body, but it doesn't cross the brain in the same way and kind of have that psychoactive effect. It doesn't make people high. The reason you see CBD in gas stations and health food stores and, literally everywhere is that the federal government passed a bill back in 2019 that allowed this an entity called hemp, which is a version of cannabis that has higher CBD and lower THC, to be kind of produced and sold nationally. And so you're seeing these products all over. The caveat, the thing that I always tell my patients about is there aren't really high quality standards for CBD products to actually be well produced and to have in them what they say they have in them. So some of these products out there are unfortunately, just snake oil, right? It's probably coconut oil and nothing else in it. And so sourcing CBD products from a reputable source is really important in terms of kind of health and efficacy.
And I think I would assume that that would also go into the care plan, depending on what someone's, why they're wanting to use it, whether it's pain management or sleep, or I guess the list goes on and on of designing a, just like with any other prescription, the right course of treatment, and then making sure, like you said, that you're accessing it from a reputable company that you know what you're getting.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Like it's kind of the same as I tell people, I look at this the same way I look at if I was prescribing you gabapentin, right? I wouldn't write the prescription and be like, well, I'll take as many as you think would work and I'll check in with you in a year. Right. So we have to treat this similarly and kind of EO's care plan and feedback loop where they're going to ask for you to sort of rate the effectiveness and be able to kind of look at and see what symptoms are being relieved or if you're getting any bad side effects. That allows us as clinicians and you as a patient to really understand what's helpful and what's not.
No, that's very helpful. And that is part of why mass retirees became interested in this topic. Again, we know that You know, many of you watching this video may be utilizing medical marijuana as a treatment option. We want to make sure that we're providing you with the information you need in order to do that effectively and safely. And in Absolutely. Particular, if these laws are changing and if insurance providers are going to, in the future, begin to cover the cost of these, just like any other prescription drug, we want to get out in front on it. We want to make sure that we're part of that conversation and that your thoughts and your feelings and your needs are really being met in a safe and effective manner. So that's really what's behind this. So again, the information you're going to provide, if you do choose to engage in the survey, which again is completely anonymous, really help to inform, you know, our position going forward, as well as the work being done by EO Care and others here in Massachusetts. So Brooke, in closing, anything that you would like to add and leave our members with?
Yeah, I think it's a really important point you made that for sort of a lot of reasons that have nothing to do with the health or medical benefits surrounding cannabis, there's a whole lot of stigma that surrounds this. You know, both kind of culturally and medically and you know, legally and all of that. And I think one of the things that I sort of think is very, very important for all of our patients, all of our members to be able to do is to be able to try to wade through all of that stigma in a way that feels like if this is something that might benefit me in terms of my day-to-day quality of life, I want to be able to use it or access it or even think about it and have a conversation that doesn't feel as kind of, you know, icky or wrong or scary in some ways. And so I think part of this is just getting the topic on the table and having more open conversations that will benefit us all.
You know, I think that's a really important point. And again, that's really what's driving, you know, our involvement. And the first step is getting information and learning the thoughts of our membership. So, you know, again, thank you very much for taking the time today. I know how busy you are. But, you know, going forward, once we receive, you know, the results of the survey, we're going to report them back to our members. And then going forward, you know, if there does seem to be an interest, we're certainly going to be, you know, providing additional information. And Dr., you know, perhaps you can join me again and we can do a little bit more of a Q&A directly with our membership at some point on this topic. I'm sure we're going to get a lot of questions.
Absolutely. I would love to. I think sort of making this feel like it's a conversation that can be more open and helpful for everybody is a really good first step.
Excellent.
So thank you so much for having me.
I appreciate it. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye.